news, everyone. Hello, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you're joining us from today. Welcome to Engineering for Change, or E4C for short. Today, we're very pleased to bring you the latest in E4C's 2013 webinar series. Today's webinar was developed in collaboration with Uncharted Play, and our guest presenter is Victor Angel. My name is Yana Aranda, and I'll be moderating today's webinar. When I'm not doing this, I work with the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, ASME, where I'm a senior program manager in the engineering department. I'd like to take a moment now to tell you a bit about today's webinar, The Art of Being a Hardware Startup. Energy and design are key focus areas at E4C, and we're always seeking to share insights and lessons learned in this area. So we're especially glad to learn about the perspective that a startup in this field has. We've invited today's presenter, Victor Angel, who is the Vice President of Product Development at Uncharted Play, along with his colleague, Manalo, who's the lead designer, to talk about some of the work that their organization has been doing. We'd like to thank you all for joining us today. Before we get rolling, I'd also like to take a moment to recognize the coordinators of the E4C webinar series generally, along with myself, Holly Schneider-Brown, Victoria Chung, and Alex Torres of IEEE, who work on developing and delivering the webinar series. Thank you, team. If anybody out there has questions about the series, please be encouraged to contact them via the email address visible on the slide, webinars@engineeringforchange.org. Before we hand things over to our presenters for today, we thought it would be a good idea to remind you about Engineering for Change and who we are. E4C is a global community of over 13,000 technically minded individuals, such as engineers, technologists, representatives from NGOs, and social scientists, working to solve critical humanitarian challenges, whether in water, energy, health, agriculture, sanitation, or other areas faced around the world today. We invite you to join E4C by becoming a member. E4C membership provides cost-free access to a growing inventory of field-tested solutions and related information from all the members of our coalition, including international development agencies such as USAID and Practical Action, professional societies like IEEE, ASCE, SWE, and ASHRAE, and academic supporters such as MIT's D-Lab, Penn State, and IIT, as well as access to a passionate, engaged community working to make people's lives better all over the world. Registration is easy and it's free. Check out our website, engineeringforchange.org, to learn more and sign up. The webinar you're participating in today is one installment of the Engineering for Change webinar series. This free, publicly available series of online seminars showcases the best practices and thinking of leaders in the field who bring leading-edge technology and solutions to bear on global humanitarian and development challenges. Information on upcoming installments in the series, as well as archived videos of past presentations, can be found on the E4C webinars page, which is engineeringforchange-webinars.org, or also on our YouTube channel, and you can see that URL listed there. If you're on Twitter today, I'd also like to invite you to join us in the conversation with the hashtag E4CWebinars. E4C's next webinar will be on April 11th at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time with Christina Barto, who is the Regional Manager, Program Manager at Mana Energy Limited. She'll be focusing on new models for delivering water and energy solutions in a talk titled Implementation and Monitoring of a Large-Scale Water and Energy Program in Rwanda. To register, we invite you to visit the E4C webinars page. A few housekeeping items before we get started. Let's see where everyone is from today. In the chat window that you see on the right-hand side of the screen, I invite you to please type in your location. I'll start to provide everybody with an example. There we go. Any technical questions or administrative problems should go in the same chat window. Feel free to send a private chat to Holly or myself if you have some specific questions. You can also use the chat window to type in any remarks you may have. During the webinar, please use the Q&A window located below the chat window to type in your questions for the presenter. That way we can keep a nice running log of clear questions for the presenters at the end. If you're listening to the audio broadcast and you encounter any trouble, try hitting stop and then start. If that does not work, you can use the caller number for the teleconference. You may also want to try opening WebEx up in a different browser. Looks like we have a lot of folks from all over today. Welcome. Following the webinar, to request a certificate of completion showing one professional development hour for those of you who are maintaining your PE license, please provide your full name and date you completed this webinar, as well as the code that we will give you at the end of the presentation. Send this to eab-cuadmin@ieee.org. All right. So let's give you a little bit of background on today's presenter. Victor Angel leads design and engineering efforts at Uncharted Play, a social enterprise with a mission to innovate, play, and empower. His focus is on creating products that act as platforms for social innovation rather than standalone devices. His upbringing in the developing world gives him an appreciation for play as a catalyst for social change and inspires him to consider social, economic, and environmental factors in his work. He holds a bachelor's in bioengineering and nanotechnology from Boston University and is a master's candidate for strategic design and management at Parsons School of Design here in New York. Welcome to Victor, and I will hand it over to him now to start with his presentation.
Great, thank you. I hope everyone can hear me all right. So as Holly mentioned, this hour is supposed to be about showing people what it means to be a hardware startup, a lot of the challenges that we face, a lot of the things that we're able to do by being a small and nimble team, and all of the new concepts that are being developed with the low barriers of entry to manufacturing, design, and innovation. So before getting into it, let me introduce Uncharted Play. Uncharted Play is a social enterprise that focuses on creating products and technologies that benefit people's lives through play. So our focus is not only on developing innovative products per se, but it's really about having a social impact bottom line. So if we get started with the story, it all originated at Harvard University, where our two co-founders, Jessica Matthews and Julia Silverman, were taking a class that was, I believe it was called Engineering for Non-Engineers or something of sorts. And they were tasked with a project to create a massive multiplayer game that addressed a global need. So rather than going online and creating some sort of computer game, they used their insights in the developing world. Jessica's from Nigeria, and Julia had actually worked in the Africa division at the World Bank. So they were both exposed to the ubiquity of soccer around the world, and they realized the potential that this sport had to convey a positive impact or to have a positive impact all over the world. So what they thought was, you know, what if we just put a shake to charge flashlight inside of a soccer ball and we make an energy harvesting soccer ball? So as you can see in the first slide, this is exactly how our company got started. They grabbed a hamster ball, they put a shake to charge flashlight, they covered it with a soccer ball skin, they kicked it around, and they realized that it was possible to create energy from that. So they got a good grade on the project, they continued with their lives, they graduated, and they both had full-time jobs, and then they realized that it was too good of an idea to pass up. But at that point, you know, they were very young, neither of them were engineers or had technical backgrounds. So what they did is they outsourced this work to a company in California that created a very robust prototype initially intended for mass manufacture. And that is sort of the point where I came in, and Joel, who's here with me today, he's the creative director, but he came in at the same stage. And we had this beautifully produced product. You can see it in the image on the far right. And we were all very excited, and you know, we received the prototypes. We go to test it in places like Mexico and Nigeria, and we realize that these prototypes are breaking everywhere. Not only that, but these balls were actually twice as heavy as a regular soccer ball. They were very hard, they were very, they didn't bounce, they hurt people's feet. So what we realized was that even though this engineering firm did a fantastic job at taking a concept and making it a working prototype, they completely missed the end user. So with that in mind, we had to, it was a difficult decision, but we had to phase all the development out of there. We internalized it. Jill and I did a lot of the initial work with the help of some wonderful interns. And we realized a couple things in the last year of redesign, which is what we're going to introduce today. The first thing that I'd like to say is that in order to create technologies that really impact the world, you need to understand your end user. So just like this California company did, you know, they had a great team of engineers, they had the right software, they had the right equipment, but they did not have the insight into who would be using this product. You know, they had no idea what conditions they'd be played in, they had no idea, I doubt that they even knew what the sport was about. You know, at some point, the conversation was, well, let's create a ball that is twice as, oh, not twice as big, but I would say like 25% larger than a traditional soccer ball. You know, so you can see that their focus was completely in a different place than really getting a product that fulfills a need in your user's life. So these pictures that I have up right now are from our distribution in Mexico, where we were testing them. As you can see, you know, kids are very interested when you first show them the product. They're very excited. It's something that's completely new to them, obviously. And it's very reassuring when you hand the ball to a kid, and it's a very familiar object to him. It's something that this kid has been seeing, you know, every day of his life. And suddenly you tell them that it's something more, you know, that suddenly he can create his own power. So it's something very, you're making something extraordinary out of something familiar. And I think that's the biggest thing that we're trying to do at Uncharted Play. And something that is essential for us to understand when creating any product, any service, or undergoing any ideation. The second thing that we really understood, and it expands from point number one, is that you really need to mind your surroundings. You know, you can't design in a vacuum. You can't design from abroad. You need to be able to have empathy and understanding for how and where your end user lives. So a very clear example is this field. I don't know if you can even call it a field, but this was in Mexico, and this is where kids in the community that we went to played every single day. You know, so as you can see, it's covered in broken brick, rocks, glass, trash, plastic bags, but it has a goalpost, and kids managed to find a way to play. The engineers that designed the original ball, they were not thinking that the ball would be used in a condition like this. They were thinking, you know, turf fields or grass fields, or dirt, if anything. But what we found is that we really need to get rid of assumptions and really observe and understand how exactly our end users living. And I think that's a great starting point for whatever design endeavor you take is starting from this observation phase of knowing, of really getting to know your user and then taking on the ideation. So with that in mind, Hailey's going to introduce a little bit more of a design-focused rules that we try to implement here at Uncharted Play.
Hey guys, so as Victor said, we had this. You know, we're working with a firm in California, and they produced this great working prototype for us that was a soccer ball that produced energy, but it was too heavy and it was too hard, and these, you know, as Victor said, these kids were hurting themselves and when playing with it, so then, you know, that leads to a product that actually is not fun to play with. And so what we tried to do is then rethink this product and figure out a way to increase the playability, get the weight down. And so what we do here at Uncharted Play is we prototype a lot. As soon as we've got a concept, we try to get it into a three-dimensional form to figure out what's working, what's not working, where can we make improvements. You can see here we've got, you know, a variety of, you know, when we knew we were going to be using a pendulum inside of our ball, you know, what the shape looked like, how much it weighed, you know, how it's interacting with the other pieces of the ball. If you come to our office, we've got, you know, pieces of, you know, all these pieces of balls and our internal mechanisms and everything all around us, because we're constantly, you know, picking things up and trying to figure out ways to make these improvements. and to be able to see them three-dimensionally and test them out. And we're constantly using things around us, you know, whatever we've got there to kind of visualize our concepts. And then that leads to failing often. It's such a positive thing to fail. I know it's kind of counterintuitive, but when you're failing, that means you are learning. So when things break and when things don't go to plan, that's when we can, you know, step back, figure out what was the area that went wrong, and then continue to ideate on around that issue to make those improvements. And it always, you know, as you continue to fail, you know that you're definitely pushing your concepts, you're pushing your ideas, and seeing how far you can take them, and making sure that you really have the best product out there. And now, so I'm going to hand it over to Joel, who's going to continue our conversation on how we prototype and how we iterate.
So you can see in this picture we have a gallery, I guess, of the different iterations we've made. And so this is, you know, based on the things we've learned from, you know, our failures, as well as getting feedback from, you know, our pilot programs in Mexico and other places. So this kind of represents our timeline. It's taken us, you know, over a year to get to where we are now from where we started with the product development firm. So we've gotten, you know, a lot. We always try to make them, each time we iterate, we try to get feedback, both from internal members of the team and externally, you know, potential end users or just anyone that's thought, that doesn't have a bias that we do, because once, you know, when you're, you know, in a company like ours where we have one product, we see this thing every day where we're deeply involved, and sometimes it's hard to get that perspective of, you know, things that are intuitive to other people that, or intuitive to us that don't make sense to other people, and vice versa. So, you know, so we always have to kind of question our design and always constantly rethink, you know, who are we building this for, who are we designing for, and kind of what comes out of that is, you know, we're probably, with all the iterations that we do, you know, we constantly, you know, we get more and more satisfied, but you'll probably never be completely happy. But because of that, or you still need to know when to let go and take that next step when it's good enough, because otherwise you'll be paralyzed and you could just be stuck in kind of an R&D loop and then never end up with anything that's actually out there for your user. So that kind of sums up kind of the way we think about design. But you know, as part of this webinar, is also to explain, you know, what it's like doing development in a startup. It's a lot different than doing it for a larger company. So one thing that we need to do as a very small team is streamline everything. So we need to optimize the roles that we have. We have six full-time employees, the two co-founders, we have interns, and everyone on our team. We have our own specialties that from college and our you know, previous work experience, but also we all wear different hats, and we do whatever it takes to get things done. We, you know, all of us have, you know, taped up boxes and taken them to FedEx, have answered emails. We've all done prototyping and sewing and cutting and kind of, we just kind of have to be all hands on deck in an environment like a startup. Another big thing is reviving ideas. Ideation is never wasted. So, you know, based on all these iterations, we come up with, you know, we have brainstorming sessions as a team, and we get all these great ideas. And sometimes they're great ideas, and the timing isn't right. Sometimes they're great ideas that are kind of off the wall, but might inspire something later on. But one thing we've learned is that it makes sense to document and save everything. Because, you know, new technological advances are made. You know, we learn something from an end user that kind of allows us to pivot, you know, the technology we're doing, or what we want to key in on, or, you know, who our audience actually is. So it makes sense to have a good archive of all these things, because you never know when they might come up again or when they'll inspire something new. And the third thing, getting the busy work out of the way. Like I mentioned, you know, we all do, you know, these kind of things that, you know, don't seem like they're as important or don't have as much value. You know, if we're entering someone, you know, we get a lot of emails about technical questions about the ball, or just kind of, we get a lot of unsolicited emails about, you know, ideas that people have. So one thing that we've learned is it's really important to kind of establish, you know, the way we all work is kind of individualized, but we try to establish our own kind of team processes. And then since we're a startup, we didn't have this stuff kind of pre-established, so we've kind of learned how we best work with each other. And so, you know, for many people, it's scheduling time where I only answer emails in the morning, or I like to do brainstorming in the afternoon because that's when I'm more creative. And it takes a lot to kind of understand that, you know, with you know, six people, it's not everyone's going to be the same, and it's not with a relatively flat organization. You're accountable to everybody, but also you're kind of accountable to nobody. It's kind of an interesting dichotomy. It's just making sure you understand how to take care of all the things you need to do, whether it's, you know, for the product or for just getting the business running. So the other thing that, you know, that kind of comes out of being in a startup is, you know, you don't have a lot of the capital investment and then the R&D budget that, you know, a larger corporation might have. So one thing we've utilized is building strong partnerships. So we don't own our own factory. We use contract manufacturers. And when we were searching, when we brought the development process internal, we wanted to keep everything relatively local so that we could visit factories whenever there were issues, and, you know, reduce shipping costs and things. But what we learned when we were looking for these vendors is we wanted to have partnerships with them for a long time, and you know, it's easy to kind of make decisions based on cost when you are so small, but you'll learn that as you, you know, send out emails and try to get quotes, that the way that some vendors correspond with you, you feel more comfortable in establishing a relationship with them because they're they do research about the company, they get excited about the product. And you kind of have to think of it as a two-way street, and you know, cost isn't the only factor in these relationships. So beyond manufacturers, you know, we use other networks. Like, we worked with a lot of universities, we worked with you know, other organizations in the local New York tech space, and there's a lot of different that help us kind of make our team bigger than the handful that we actually are. Because it's a very sharing ideas and sharing technology is something that's you know, very inspiring to a lot of companies, and it's people they want to help out when you're a startup. So the third thing, playing on existing platforms, you know, we use a lot of different web platforms. So some of you may know that we just recently used Kickstarter to kind of fund our mass manufacturing. You know, we use PayPal for payments. We use free project management and out-of-date software, just because there's plenty of things out there that are helpful that, you know, don't take a lot of investment. They're good enough for what we need at this point. You know, for things like CAD software, we apply for a grant with Autodesk, and they're able to give us a severely reduced price on their software, so that's what we use for 3D modeling. And usually, like, you know, having these good ideas and just going out there and trying to find things that are out there, that, and there's a lot of people that want to help you, and, you know, might not be intuitive, but it's always worth a shot just asking.
I think we're having a little bit of problems with static. Let's see if it's better now.
Yes, that seems a little better. Yeah, it must be some sort of glitch in the matrix, if you will.
Great.
So please do go on. Apologies.
All right. And so with all that in mind, so we have, there's definitely something that you know, working at a hardware startup, but you always have to keep in mind is embracing uncertainty. We have an example here where on the left you see the CAD version of one of our first balls after the product development team we worked with in California. And this was, you know, we were going to mold this whole singular piece and then have a top that comes, a patch that comes in with the mechanism inside. And then when we got the one of the first, actually this is after a couple iterations too, the one of the balls back from our manufacturer in China, it was certainly not round and that did not look like what we had, what our CAD was. And, you know, it's constantly constantly moving back and forth and working with your vendor and trying to, you know, to fix these things that aren't, you know, coming out as you originally intended. But you do need to just, you know, stay very positive during things like this, because you never know what's going to happen when you send files out to China, or, you know, when you get these pieces back, they may not be exactly what you had planned, but, you know, to work through those issues. And always have creative confidence. So we're, you know, as I said before, we're constantly iterating in our office and, you know, creating prototypes. You can see with whatever we've got around us. And it's important to, you know, when you're participating in this process, to be supporting one another as you're ideating, you know, coming up with these different solutions, and just once you guys figure out a path that you feel works, you know, go with it and support each other and figure out, you know, who can do what within that process. And I think kind of, you know, going along with that creative confidence, it's very important to kind of leave room for this. This idea of play. Now we're obviously a company that deals with a product that is intended for play, so we're constantly kicking around balls in the office. But it does help if you incorporate this type of positive play into your work. So when you're brainstorming and when you're ideating, you're keeping this kind of lighthearted kind of air about your work. And it definitely leads you to more innovative, more creative solutions.
So with that said, after a whole year of redesigning and running into a number of challenges, both from a design perspective and from a design and engineering perspective and a manufacturing operational perspective, we've gotten to a point where the current iteration is actually, it's about the same weight as a traditional soccer ball. So often people disbelieve that there's actually a mechanism in there that's generating electricity. We made a ball that is soft enough for kids to play around with, to hit it with their heads, with their feet, whatever they want, without getting hurt. And it's a ball that lasts as well. So as you can see, the technical specs were something that are pretty demanding in terms of the product that we need. You know, we need a ball, or we need a product that's going to be kicked around, it's going to be abused, it's something that's going to be out in the elements, water, dirt, yet you want it to last. So it was complicated alone in terms of design and engineering, but I think one of the biggest challenges and one of the biggest learning experiences was really learning to manufacture and to produce. And to Joel's point, it's really about building strong networks, finding the right people that are willing to collaborate with you. It's very different to outsource and give the work to someone else and expect them to figure out with you than to collaborate in solving it together. And that's one of the biggest things that we found, is that you need to be able to be a part of the process regardless of where the actual work is being done. So not just, you know, not because the work is being done at someone else's facility doesn't mean that you need to be hands-on. Quite the contrary, you have to be on top of what's going on, making sure that these people understand who the end user is, make sure that they are prototyping early, make sure that they are failing often. One thing that we found is that being such a young startup, we're also very comfortable failing. And that is something that a lot of larger, some of our larger partners are not comfortable with. You know, they're companies that have thrived on reliability over time, and that's part of their value proposition. So it's an interesting give and take where you have to be able to push them further and make sure that they're comfortable with pushing their own boundaries in order to produce the best product. So we're at a very exciting time. And like Hailey said, it's all about embracing uncertainty. And right now we're at a point where we're about to launch this new SOCCKET campaign, both abroad and the retail market here in the United States. So we don't know what's going to happen next, but we're using this creative confidence to know that whatever challenges may arise, we're going to be able to solve them as a team and learn from our users and open up these channels of communication, get feedback from all of you in terms of what we should be focusing on and what we should be working on next. So we have a picture missing on what's next for Uncharted Play, but we had a nice picture there of a couple kids playing around with a ball, tinkering with it. And that's a big thing that we want to create is we want to make sure that people understand that this product is not the solution or the cure to the world energy crisis. A lot of people ask us, you know, what's the kilowatt hour of, you know, production of your ball? And those are numbers that, quite frankly, I doubt that we will ever reach. But what we will do is we will have an impact in people's lives by teaching them about the benefits of sustainability and the viability of sustainability as a positive force in people's lives. A lot of people right now believe that being sustainable is about making sacrifices, and what we want to teach people is that being sustainable is actually about enjoying life a little bit more, you know, making fun functional, which is what this company is all about, and it's what's in our DNA as an organization. So we will open the floor now for any questions or discussions that you guys want to have. By the way, this is a picture of one of our pilot programs in Brazil. And a quick anecdote is those are the balls that look like watermelon / eggs. We were pretty frightened to go out to a country like Brazil that, you know, lives, eats, breathes soccer and give them balls that weren't round. So we were pretty hesitant. We got there and kids loved it. You know, they did admit that it was a little funky to be playing around with balls that weren't round. But they fully embraced it, and I believe that was one of the, again, we regained that creative confidence where as soon as you see what you're doing to that child's life, it really pushes us as an organization to keep on iterating, keep on improving the product. And, you know, these are the experiences that are very valuable in designing for social change is, again, being in touch with your end user. So, we can open up to questions.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Victor, Joel, Hailey. We already have one question that's come in, and for those of you who are interested in asking some questions, please do type them into the Q&A window, which is just below the chat window. So the first question that we have on the table is regarding funding, and this person wants to know if you can talk a little bit about the funding sources and the debt load at this point of product maturity.
Yes, of course. The funding, we're bootstrapped right now, so we have not taken any outside investment. It all started with some seed money, friends and family, and then we were lucky enough to get support from corporate sponsors. So we had companies like State Farm, Toyota, media companies in Latin America give us money. Some were in the form of grants, simply because they believed in what we did. And others were in exchange for small pilot programs. So a lot of these companies have a strong sustainability CSR initiative fund, and we were able to benefit from that, and that has really, really helped out our development. Mm-hmm. We're starting to move away from that and starting to go directly into retail sales. So that is why we're on Kickstarter for one more week. We actually just made our mark, I believe, yesterday or the day before. So it was pretty exciting. And all that money is actually going into expanding our manufacturing capacity. So, yeah, we're trying to make it work without outside investment at this point.
Got it. Questions are coming in, so I'm just going to try to go through these. Can you please describe, and actually I had this question as well, so it's a great question, how you source your manufacturer? What mechanism did you use to identify who the credible manufacturer, I believe, in China was that you ultimately used?
So primarily when we brought things inside, we wanted to maintain as much control as we could, so we focused all of our search domestically, you know, even locally in the New York State, New Jersey area. You know, we started out kind of just like, I guess how anybody would with Google, and we had our preliminary design and our CAD files, and we sent emails, made phone calls, and kind of talked about what we were trying to do, and you know, we talked about volumes, but. It was very much a back and forth discussion. So, just after the initial kind of conversation, we talked about, you know, our vision in terms of how many we want to make and how we want to keep everything domestic. And it was very much a comparison and just from dealing with the different I guess styles of communication from the different contract manufacturers. We were able, you know, a few certain ones were able to rise kind of to the top, and where we felt comfortable. Kind of forming these partnerships and making, you know, basically making purchase orders for quite a large production volume. And it was, you know, it's relatively time intensive and you know, we beyond just the relationships, obviously their technical skills were important. So, you know, we would ask them for, you know, potential improvements that they could see and how they could recommend something becoming more manufacturable. So it was very much, you know, just started with, you know, internet searches and then just, you know, more correspondence, back and forth, phone calls, visiting, and a lot of them, you know, luckily were very into the cause and the actual product. So that was, you know, when they showed kind of an excitement about the product, that kind of, I guess earned them bonus points because it kind of showed that they were very interested in the company itself, and you know, there are some vendors would give short emails with, you know, just, you know, one word answers, and they didn't seem like organizations that we really wanted to work with. So a lot of it was a feel and kind of a that kind of thing, but you know, and then it was for regarding. Sourcing overseas, it's a little bit harder. We don't have any kind of native Chinese speakers. We have a couple of things purchased in China, but mostly off-the-shelf things. So with that, we also just used, you know, the internet, Alibaba, and then luckily we had kind of the specs in mind where we kind of just do kind of a more of a straight cost comparison. You know, we need a battery that's a certain milliamp hours and this certain connector and that kind of thing. But in terms of all the manufactured products, we made sure it was important to us to keep it domestic.
I understood. And just out of curiosity, did you reach out to any other producers and designers of products for underserved communities or the developing world to consult with them regarding their manufacturers, preferred manufacturers?
Not particularly. Luckily, I mean, I had the experience that I worked for an electronics connector company previously, and I was able to be surrounded by, you know, very experienced engineers that, you know, had 20 years of experience in injection molding or in metal stamping and that kind of thing. So I kind of learned a lot about the process in terms mm-hmm. of how to find things and kind of, you know, what's important and what considerations you have to make. So but I kind of had, you know, kind of a exposure to that kind of thing. So we knew what questions to ask, which is mm-hmm. was a big thing. But yeah, we didn't really do too much, you know, surveying the you know, the other, you know, the hardware startup scene for our parts.
Understood. So we're going to change gears here a little bit because we have a question that's come in that's related a little bit more to the culture of soccer, and specifically this participant wants to know about the end users of your product, and she notes that most of the pictures you shared show boys playing with a ball. She wants to know if girls enjoy this product as well and how you're incorporating their needs into this design, and if it's okay to expand a little bit on this question and add to that adults, what we see as kids here, and whether, you know, needs of adults differ for the ball, and maybe how you're accommodating that. So you can speak to the girls' question and also to the adults' part.
Yeah. So most of the pictures we do have here do show boys. We do have, you know, when we go to these countries, we do have a lot of young girls playing with them as well. We just in this presentation have most of the boys shown. But something that we do work on when we do these distributions, when we did one in Brazil, we've got a member of our team works on developing curriculum around specific issues that are important to, you know, not only that community but to our distribution partners. And so, you know, one of the ones we did in Brazil was around gender equity. So building a curriculum around that and introducing that to the girls and the young boys as well. So using the SOCCKET as an education tool as well. So that's one way that we're able to engage both, the men and women. And as for the adults, we have had adults, play with the ball. Our target is the younger kids, but also as we've seen in, you know, when we bring it domestically, there's a lot of interest in, individuals of, you know, college age and, you know, our age as well, the members of our startup that do just like this idea of, the fact that you can play with this product and it can produce light, and you're kind of, you know, shedding light on, these issues that are very global issues, and, you know, the idea that, you know, there's so many people around the world that don't have that access to reliable energy.
Right, absolutely. So kind of related to that, I'm going to piggyback off of this person's question and mash in somebody else's, which is, are there any plans for you to adapt the device to other types of ball-related sports like volleyball or basketball?
Yes, definitely. I think, those are things that we've been working on for the past, for the past few months, is really expanding our product line beyond that. One of the things that we have in mind, and, you know, it's back to our social impact bottom line, is soccer was very appealing to us simply because of the ability to distribute it worldwide to people who really need this sort of positive impact in their lives. So when deciding what technology to develop next, I think that it's more than just, you know, grabbing all these low-hanging fruits and incorporating the technology into all different ball sports, but really focusing on what sport is going to have the highest impact. So again, it brings some additional complexity to our product development, in the sense that it's not only technology, engineering, and design; it's really engineering, design, and whatever's happening out in the field with the people.
Social science, right? Absolutely. So in terms of getting that reach, in addition to the layer of, the sport that's the most ubiquitous, I would, I suppose, also ask to this other question, which is, how are you literally distributing? Are you selling this directly or through some distribution service network?
Can you repeat that? Sorry.
So the question was, are you selling the product directly using some sort of distribution service network, or is it, I'm going to explain
right
model,
now,
or is it perhaps through NGOs?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right now our model has been, you know, for the past year for the pilot programs, is a large corporation will sponsor balls, and then we find mm-hmm. NGOs on the ground to distribute them, simply mm-hmm. because, you know, as Hailey mentioned, we don't just want to hand off merchandise in communities and leave. We actually want to have follow-through. We want to incorporate educational programs, and that's part of our sustainability model. As I mentioned, our sustainability is not just the fact that you're producing energy. It's the fact that you're educating people about energy conservation. And then you can add layers to that as, you know, sports for development, which is a pretty big field right now. But yeah, we definitely have NGOs on the ground to help us with distribution. And then in terms of retail, which is what we're about to transition into, we're probably going to do direct, probably mm-hmm. an online store.
Mm-hmm. Got it. So the with these questions are kind of bouncing back and forth a little bit between culture and technology. But we'll take on to the cultural aspect again. You talked about the importance of being in the field to understand people's needs and environment. How often has the team traveled in the last year of development to do field testing?
We travel about, this last year we did about two or three visits. We try to make them long. I mean, it's unfortunate that we can't go more often, simply because, again, we're short-staffed, and the resources aren't there for us to spend that much time on the field. But we definitely want to incorporate a lot more integration. So one of the benefits that we do have is we have very close communication with our partners on the ground. So we piggyback off of NGOs' networks to really get that feedback from our users in certain communities. So back to that don't reinvent the wheel concept. You know, why build a network on the ground if you can just partner with the right people who already dedicate themselves to do that?
Absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. And now we're going to, again, go back to the technical side. I have a feeling Joel is going to come into play here. What is the estimated useful life of the soccer ball version?
Right now, we're still testing it, but we predict that the mechanism, probably 1 or 2 years before repairability. So one of the things that we're designing right now is a system. So the balls were designed for repairability, but right now we try to incorporate a system with the NGOs to repair the balls to extend their useful life. So one of the truths in everything is that everything breaks and everything will eventually fail, from airplanes to balls to whatever you want to consider. Mm-hmm. But one of the
Hopefully
things that we want to
left.
but one of the things that we want to have is make sure that these balls are, you know, even if the mechanism breaks or people want to take it out and use it for something else, that kids are still playing with a ball, right? So the ball is actually deflation proof. One of the things that we found is that soccer balls that are donated to underserved communities end up in the landfill within weeks. If you saw a picture of that field, there's glass, there's rocks. So one of the things that we had as a requirement was that the ball could not deflate. And, you know, right now we have a waterproof, deflation-proof ball. So durability is a big, big, big concern for us.
It's incredibly critical. I think it's important that folks realize that you've committed to this. To kind of expand a little bit more on this, I'm wondering, in terms of any complementary technical systems that, you know, plug and play with the ball. I know your picture was missing in your presentation, but I have the privilege of having seen the deck offline, so I know there was an image of a light that plugs in, but if you could maybe talk a little bit about any complementary systems and anything that you're thinking of for the future.
So we're doing a lot of, you know, in the office we're constantly playing and prototyping different, you know, using our technology and seeing what else, you know, what else we can put that in, kind of back to what the question Victor had answered earlier. We prototyped a few things in the office that we can plug our light into. That, you know, we're hoping at some point we'll find that they'll be very useful and we can get those off the ground. But what else is? Oh yeah, we also have, you know, if you go on our Kickstarter, I think we actually, one of our stretch goals was we've already developed a cell phone charger that plugs into plugs into our ball. And so we want to continue. Yeah, we want to continue and develop that. I mean, that's always, you know, that's always one of the questions that people, you know, people ask, like, you know, can I charge my phone? Can I charge my laptop? And of course, we want people to keep in mind that, you know, this is a ball for areas that have, little to no access to reliable energy. So we're giving them by, you know, it's a small output, but, you know, there's a 6-watt LED light that plugs into the ball, and that gives you, you know, it's a very high ratio of, or a very positive, you know, output that, you know, if you just play with the ball for 30 minutes, you can get this 3 hours of light, because it's, you know, an appliance that doesn't, you know, suck all the energy out of it, versus, mm-hmm. you know, if your phone will, you know, drain that mm-hmm. battery very quickly, and your laptop will, you know. So, of course, Absolutely. It needs a lot more power. Yeah, but things we would ultimately love to, you know, go out. We've got prototypes of speakers in office as well, and just other mm-hmm. things that we just want to make sure, you know, right now it's the light is something that very much is a need. We want to make sure, you know, that we continue to design in that way that we're, you know, we're filling these needs for people. And individuals around the world, and not just, you know, what else can we plug into this ball? Make sure that there yeah. definitely is meaning to that.
I'm gonna kind of also pull on that thread a little bit in terms of the light. I'm wondering, as most folks maybe are aware, there is a lot of off-grid lighting solutions that have been developed over the past few years for underserved communities worldwide, and I'm wondering if there are any standards or any guidelines that you adhere to or referenced in designing or even sourcing your light to ensure that, for example, the lumen output was sufficient for these dark homes for a certain period of time and so forth, just as an example. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, right now the lamp that we use is actually a modified off-the-shelf reading lamp, so it's a high-efficiency LED mm-hmm. that's commonly used for, it's a task light. So mm-hmm. we didn't actually design the lamp per se. Mm-hmm. So it's something that all those considerations that you have and based on the field observations that we've received over the past year, it's something that we want to redesign completely, simply because I feel like we could have a different lamp that satisfies the user's needs a little bit better. Mm-hmm. LED, the benefits of LED is that it's very high efficiency. So again, mm-hmm. we go back to this question that people ask, you know, how many kilowatts per hour can you produce? It's really, really our power output is best described through the light that we're able to generate thanks to the efficiency of the LED. So mm-hmm. that's one of the pros, but the cons of LED is that it's a very direct lighting. It's very direct lighting mm-hmm. and it's mm-hmm. not very warm. So one yeah. of the things that we want to try, and one of the prototypes we have are ways that we can make this lamp just as efficient but a little bit warmer, you know, create this this ambient lighting that people sometimes mm-hmm. require, right? So we're substituting kerosene lamps, we're substituting candles, which people usually use to interact around a dinner table or
right.
Or similar scenarios. So it's definitely something that's on our minds and something that we're working on right now.
Interesting. And final question, at least for me, if anybody else has any more questions out there, please do type them into the Q&A window. Otherwise, I'm going to selfishly continue asking questions that I'm interested in. So in terms of the monitoring and evaluation of the socket, you mentioned that you have NGO partners who are, you know, distributing the balls and also getting feedback from the ground. Do you have a program that you've implemented that is consistent for all NGOs, or NGOs, are they developing their own kind of monitoring scheme for the socket?
We've been very fortunate to have great NGO partners. They're incredibly receptive mm-hmm. to our immediate needs, in the sense that right now we're still developing this product. You know, we have yet to sign off on, okay, this is the end-all be-all of this generation, right? So we're constantly iterating. And with that comes a lot of feedback that we need that is very product specific, mm-hmm. but also this early design observation phase. So right now in the office we have a social development team. You know, it's about three people, and they're focused, you know, every single day in creating these relationships, these partnerships, and the methods to do M&E effectively. So let's say that we have a company sponsors 5,000 balls. We distribute those to Mexico where we have our NGO. Our NGO will usually have curriculum already done, you know, that they're doing with a certain community, be it sports for development or similar. And what they do is they work with their social development team to co-create an additional curriculum that factors in the SOCCKET into their existing framework.
All right. So additional question here is, have you thought of asking, this is maybe a good idea for you guys, or maybe you came up with it, have you thought of asking major international soccer teams to sponsor the production and distribution?
Yeah, definitely. I think right now we have some clients in Spain who are very interested. Again, we're still being a little bit cautious in terms of what product we offer, because we want to make sure that it's up to what we want it to be. Right now we're only doing pilot programs this year, so right now we're at the very, very final stages of development. We're about to go back and kind of touch base with all these clients that have been waiting and excited to sponsor balls. Definitely we have a couple soccer teams on there and a couple individual soccer players that, through their foundations, want to support us.
Yeah. Fantastic. I'm not sure if there's someone on the line who's also speaking and not on mute, but we can hear you, so perhaps you might want to mute yourself. One more question that's come in is regarding customer needs and acknowledging that, you know, understanding user needs is such a challenge for those who are trying to design products for developing communities. So I know you spoke a little bit about the importance of that, but perhaps I think this individual wants to know your methodology for determining people's needs before you designed, or maybe if you can speak if it's a particular method that you applied in determining needs, doing needs analysis.
Yeah. Hailey, I think is best qualified.
So from the beginning, the actual the SOCCKET itself, you know, we've talked about kind of the, you know, where that was born, and our two co-founders, Jessica and Julia, have a very strong understanding of the developing world through, you know, through, of course, where, you know, Jessica was born, and then, you know, through their travels and everything. So that's, so kind of, you know, for the SOCCKET, you know, itself, that's, they definitely were in tune to the needs just through the fact that they've, you know, lived in that sort of environment. And then, you know, as we continue to, you know, design, you know, to improve the ball and design appliances and things around that and design new products, the method, especially from the product development standpoint, is we definitely focus on the human-centered design model. So you're focusing on hear, create, and develop, and there's all, you know, within each one of those sections, there's a whole variety of types of, you know, different methodologies and different ways of going about acquiring this information, you know, a lot through observation and questions, you know, questionnaires and things like that tend to be the easiest ones to go to. But there are a whole, you know, and I encourage, you know, everyone who's, you know, from product development, you know, I'm a industrial design background engineer, do definitely keep in mind this HCD process, this human-centered design process. Because there's so many different methods out there, definitely look at, you know, each challenge is going to be different, and each, you know, each scenario that you're in is going to be different. You need to find the right method that works for, you know, one, that specific community, the, you know, your time constraints, you know, your location. But that's, you know, that's where we pull our methodology from. And we've got, you know, two members of the team here who kind of have a strong understanding of that method and have used that before, and that's where we kind of jump off from when we're considering these needs of these individuals, you know, and that's true for, you know, not only, you know, needs in the developing world, these very core essential needs, but also, you know, designing any product.
Absolutely, couldn't agree with you more. And for all of you who are watching the chat window, I've posted a link to IDEO's Human Centered Design Toolkit, which is free, open source for anybody who wants to learn more on how to apply this method. And then the last minute, we've had someone brainstorming on here, and he's wondering if you've already thought of this idea, or and maybe you have, but what about a translucent ball that emanates light as well?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a beautiful concept. I think we would love to do that. And that's certainly something that we're thinking of is, as we go into retail markets, is how do we spice up the ball? You know, people, consumers, especially here in New York, they love to have limited editions. They love to have customized products. So something that we want to start offering is making the balls that go out to retail be a little more unique. So, but that's definitely a good idea and something that we would love to do.
Well, maybe you can get in touch with this particular individual. You can see his name right there. sir, you see the website, so perhaps you guys have a future staffer here already. So with that, we have come to the end of our webinar. I'd like to thank all of you, Victor, Hailey, Joel, for joining us today and sharing all of the amazing work that you've been doing. For those of you who are still online, FYI, I would like to post here the professional development hours code that you can email to eab-ceuadmin@ieee.org to get your PE hours. If you have any more questions, feel free to email us at webinars@engineeringforchange.org. And, of course, we have to do a little selfish self-promotion here. Don't forget to become an E4C member to get more information on upcoming webinars. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day, night, morning, whatever it may be, wherever you are. And we look forward to seeing you on our next webinar on April 11th. Cheers.
Excellent. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.